it's better late than ever. We're trying some, to do something here, working hard at it, and struggling with it, and still I'm finished, but we're doing the best we can, so I hope you bear with us, and I hope you get something out of this, as trying to put together something about this pandemic that we're under, and the implications of it, and praying that God would help you to say something of value to you in it, and even, maybe even be a little risky with the, with my approach to it, because I don't see anybody really saying this that has a handle on it correctly, and I'm not saying that I do, but I'm trying to have, and I think it's something that needs to be said, and I think God wants me to say it, so I'm going to try. Here we go. All of us, I've been watching television and watching everything that's going on and the things that are happening and the responses that people have. And the other day I was watching some newscaster from Canada. I kind of like him. He's on Fox News. And he sets in for Rush Limbaugh every once in a while. But he was talking and he was kind of ranting and wasn't like him. And what I got out of that is he was saying, you know, we're going to get back to work, blah, blah, blah. We're going to get back to our lives. And then I noticed everybody's doing that. And everybody's fed up with being cooped up and they're wanting to get out of their confinement, and they're wanting to get into living the life that they had before, which I agree with some of the crazies out there that we may never be able to do that. I don't think we've ever gotten back from 9/11 to where we were before that. But I do know this, things are happening that just aren't normal, and there's a reason for it. We're heavily invested in life. All of us possess an idea of what life is about. And as a minister and a student of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, I've struggled with this all my life, watching people. I cannot understand how people can live their entire life being satisfied with the concept they have of life. So we all possess an idea of life, and we're all heavily invested in it, and we quickly tell other people what our opinions of life are. And we're satisfied with life as we live it. I don't mean we're satisfied with our life, but that everything that happens to us is satisfying, or that we're even satisfied with life in general, but we are obviously satisfied with our concept of life because we keep living the way that we're living. And we keep going down a path like we had this read-only memory that you just keep using over and over again. We just go down the same old road and doing the same things until we can't do it anymore. And maybe God is trying to get our attention. We're on autopilot, and we've been living this postmodern world and living in it and having our aspirations in it. And whenever God puts us in quarantine and we can't get around and play with our toys and do the things that we do, virtual reality is not as fun as it was when it's the only reality that we can invest ourselves in. And God is catching us on that and making us say, think about it. He's making us think about some things. Think about this. We're all in lockdown. The whole world, not just me and a few of us, not just the whole world is in lockdown. Even Sweden is in lockdown. And who did this to us? Not the Democrats or the Republicans or even the communists, China. Our politicians are only doing what they must do. It's not as though they can not comply and say, we're not going to pass that bill. We're going to pass a bill outlawing coronavirus. I don't know how you thought about that. Somebody should have come up with that. Could have got some people on board with that. They have no choice. This is an amazing thing that they have no choice. Democrats are wearing masks and staying at home. Look at them all, and they look like they might be going to rob a bank. But they're in agreement with Republicans who are doing the same thing, that they must comply. Did I say they're in agreement with Republicans? Democrats and Republicans in agreement? Communists are even wearing masks and only being totalitarian over their own homes right now. There is no way to deny that a force more powerful than Nancy Pelosi is doing this and has caused this. They don't know how to do these kind of things. It was a power that made her Pelosi and all politicians agree that they need to come together in a bipartisan effort to resolve the pandemic that we're all struggling under. This is something big. What kind of a person could cause politicians all across the world to start agreeing on anything, even something bad? Any way you want to look at it, God has done this to us. We may have let our enemy do it. Somebody says, well, it just stuff happens. Nothing happens that God isn't around and knows about. It may be something like that, but God knows it. And God's in control. And when something like this happens, you have to stop and think about it. When a pandemic happens and people are caught in it and they're having to stay at home and they're having to contemplate their own life, when I'm struggling with this, I see it as what I call an ontological principle. Aristotle and Plato played with this word, the meaning and reason for behind all things, and some said the ontological thing, argument for the existence of God, if he can see him, and if you can think about it in your mind, even an atheist who, the fool who says that Psalms 14:1-53, the fool has said in his heart, there is no God. The fool has a concept of God. And when you have that concept of this being in which there can be no greater, Anson said that it proves his existence. But his argument was argued by Hume and Kant as not being logical, and because you can think it, it doesn't mean that it exists, and they have all these things, and most people threw that away. But as I study the things of theology and religion and philosophy and science, I began to find something that whenever I revisited him, I realized that he was saying something more than what we give him credit for. And that is, in everything you think, you come to a point, an intersection, that it can't be going anywhere else. And in my studies, I found that there's a place where you get to where there is no onion. You can't. I can't think of his name now. C.S. Lewis said, peeling the onion skin. Whenever philosophers get together, they keep peeling one piece of the onion off, and one piece of the onion, and another. There's always another layer, and another layer. And it's kind of like the National Treasure movie when they said, one lead leads to another lead, and it just keeps going on and on and on. And it seems that way in philosophy and religion, sometimes even in science. But what you do, if you're patient, and you're persistent, and you mean business, like Madame Curie, you just keep peeling that onion skin, and all of a sudden you get to a place. You get to a place where there is no other answer other than it goes beyond anything that we, in our cause and effect reality, can comprehend, and is something that is an ontological problem. It's the opposite of Occam's razor, where the most simplest thing that you can think of that can solve the problem is the solution. It's the more complex one. There's a real existence, and it's only one explanation, and it goes beyond us, and that's God. And I've come to that place in my studies many times where you can have no other answer, but it's just God. You butt right into Him. You go to the place where logic has to say, there is no other place beyond this. It has to be God. Philosophers argue about what caused this and what caused that and what is this. And maybe the ultimate is this in the philosophical world. Why is there something instead of nothing at all? Why is there something instead of nothing at all? That's an ontological problem. It's God. There's no better real or alternative reason than logically speaking than that. So, he's literally shut down the world economy. And we're still alive. We're in time out. This is a good thing for us. This is a good thing for us. A great thing, as a matter of fact, when you think about it, and that's the whole point. We need to think about it. And here's where I get into trouble, and here's where people are afraid to go. God is chastising us. Hebrews 12:1-13. The reason it's a good thing is because of the simple fact that we're still here. It tells me that God loves us still. He's still working with us. Hebrews 12, and this is the NIV, which I don't like very much, but here it is. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witness, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles us, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart in your struggles against sin. You haven't resisted to the point of shedding your blood. And you've forgotten, and here's what I should have been starting with, and you've forgotten that the word of encouragement that addresses you as sons and daughters of God. My son, my daughter, do not make light of the Lord's discipline, and do not lose heart when he rebukes you, because the Lord disciplines those he loves, and he punishes every one he accepts as a child of his. Endure hardship as discipline. God is treating you as children. For what son or daughter is not disciplined by his father? If you are not disciplined, and everyone undergoes discipline of some kind, then you are illegitimate children, not true sons at all. Moreover, we have had human fathers who disciplined us, and we respected them for it, most of us anyway. How much more should we submit to our father of spirits and live? Our fathers disciplined us for a little as they saw best, but God disciplines us for far our good, that we may share in his holiness. No discipline seems to be pleasant at this time, but painful. Later on, however, perseverance, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who have been trained by it. And that's why we're here on this planet. We're not here to build bigger barns. We're here to learn how to have righteousness and peace and to live through eternity. Therefore, strengthen your feeble arms and your weak knees, and make level paths for your feet, so that the lame may not be disabled, but rather healed. And that's what God is trying to get our attention to tell us. This is good news for us, because we're not dead. Now, I must explain this. Being an apologetic preacher, I can already see bleeding heart Brutuses out there, so here is some corrupted Shakespeare for you. In Shakespeare's play concerning Brutus and Antony, Brutus murdered Caesar and thought he had done a noble thing, and Antony gets up there and talks about the noble Brutus and kind of lets him have it. That's what I'm going to do. It's a deadliness position. My version of Shakespeare, the situation. Friends, Christians, countrymen, lend me your ears. I come to bury Christ, as all noble wish to do, not to praise him, as only the unlearned do. The evil that men do lives after them. The good is oft interred with their bones. This part is hard to make fit, because Christ is resurrected, but let's go on. This is the point here. Christ is resurrected. So let it be with Christ in his burial. The noble Brutus and Agnes, an agnostic, those moral people fit to judge the Christ, have told us that Christ was an ambitious man. If it were so, it was a grievous fault. We know that such noble ones as Brutus and Agnes would never give a biased assessment of Christ. We can trust Brutus, an even more honest and concerned for us, Agnes. And grievously has Christ answered for it. He has paid for it on the cross. Here, under the leave of Brutus and the rest of the agnostics by permission, for Brutus is an honorable man, so are they all who doubt Christ, honorable people. Come I to speak in Christ's funeral. However, he's not here, for he is risen. He was my friend. He still is. Faithful and just to me from the day he took me under his wing. But Agnes says he was ambitious, and Brutus is an honorable man. And Christ had brought many captives home to death. Bloody God, genocide God, wrathful God, bully God, a real brute. Whose ransoms did he, the gentle coffins, fill the public treasury for Romans? But for us, tithes and offerings. Did this in the Christ seem ambitious, as Brutus would say? When that the poor had cried, Christ wept with them. Ambition should be more of a stern herself than this. Yet Agnes says he was ambitious, and Agnes is an honorable man. You all did see that on the exceeding high mountain, thrice Satan presented him with a kingly crown, which he denied three times. Was that ambition? Yet Brutus says he was an ambitious man, and sure he is an honorable man, Brutus says. I speak not to disprove what Agnes and Brutus spoke or how they say these things, but here I am to speak what I do know. You should all love him once, and without cause. What cause holds us, then, to mourn for him? O judgment, thou art fallen or fled to Brutus, brutish beasts. Basically, Agnes. And men have lost their reason. Bear with me. My heart is in the supposed to be casket or funeral, but it's in the resurrection with Christ, and I must not pause from speaking until he comes back, or I die in the faith. But not as an honorable man like Agnes, of course. I said we are not dead, but the atheists will challenge this. What about the thousands that died from coronavirus? That's a great question. Too bad it's not asked in an honorable way while looking for the possibility that there could be an honorable answer. Why is it too bad? Because there is one. First, the whole world is drifting further and further away from God. He is the reason the whole world could exist and even drift in the first place. Why would he continue to work and to support a world that hates him and believes he does not exist? Why should he support anything we do when we do not even give him the time of day and we're more interested in playing our virtual reality games and investing in this present world than to think about his eternity, which was the reason we were all created for in the first place? He did not depart from us. We turned and walked away from him. And now that we can't find him, we don't see him, why would he be in a far country? Why would he be in the pits of hell where we want to be? Why would anyone support their enemy's attempts to go against everything that you stand for? After all, some would object by stating that he did not exist, but none would object that this is what would and does happen to anyone who tries to do good, as he is purported to have done. In other words, this is what Agnes would do to him if he were here, because Brutus is a noble man. Let's look at God's side of the story. Romans 1 and 17 through 32. For herein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. But let's go on. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth and unrighteousness. And that's too many of us. Because that which may be known of God is manifested in them, for our God hath showed it unto all of us. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that we are without excuse. Because that when we knew God, most of us glorified him not as God, neither were we thankful, but we become vain in our imaginations, and our foolish heart was darkened. This was written 2,000 years ago, could have been written yesterday. Professing ourselves to be wise, we become fools. And we change the glory of God into a corruptible image made like to corruptible man, or to birds, or to four-footed beasts, or to creeping things, or to non-existent things. First reason God gives us up is this. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanliness through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie, and worshiped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. Second reason God gives us, for this cause God gave us up into vile affections, for even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature, and likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another, men working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error, which was a third reason God gives us up. Even so, as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind. How does a reprobate mind see God? It does. It's reprobate. To do those things which are not convenient, being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, worship, whisperers, backbite, oh, right, whisperers, oh yeah. despiteful, proud boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, they not only do these things, but they have pleasure in them that do them. I'm talking about this postmodern world we live in. Why would God bring it along with our way? Maybe to get our attention. Maybe to save us from the pits of hell. Maybe we should listen. You see, it is not as if Brutus or Agnes are innocent victims of God's evil deeds. Who are they to judge God? The reason they accuse God of evil is to escape their own condemning conscience. I've been doing ministry for 50 years, and I have not seen a notable Brutus in my life. They're accusing God of the exact evil they are accomplishing and trying. Let's look at it this way. Why would I say they're accusing God of the exact evil they are accomplishing and doing the opposite? Let me say something about that. They're doing that because of this. They read in the scriptures about the most noble being who's ever lived, and I can give you a list of the great scholars of the world, atheists and non-atheists alike, that would agree with that, that Jesus was a noble man. And then they are acting noble and saying that he somehow wasn't. Who would you think would be the one guilty of the ignobleness? How many of them have bled, resisting sin unto death? How many of them have hung on the cross for their enemies? None. The second thing, there is nothing that happens in this present finite life that is not fixable 70 times 7 in the next. To the total satisfaction of anybody offended, God will fix it. You see, an agnostic will offer 1,000 reasons why this is not acceptable to them. But all of those objections are offered are based upon the present world, a finite world, finite existence, as if the next life does not really exist, because if you have a mind like theirs, it does not exist. However, this is the point of conflict. Their belief that it doesn't exist and ours that it does. This is the point to be proven, which they have not. Unwittingly, they are conflating their infinite, their finite life into God's eternal goal, eternal goals, and God is coming up short. Well, he would the way they do that. You can't do this. If they are right, then God would be unjust. Nevertheless, they're wrong. God is justified in his actions and the eternal where his purpose lies for us. That's where this is supposed to end up. Not on this place. Not when we're standing over the globe and dust to dust and ashes to ashes. It's not over. It's only over to the faithless. Those of us who are in faith realize there's a resurrection coming for all of us. Hey, dead, evil people, there's a resurrection for you. I would not say it would be good, though. Pestilence is a form of chastisement in the Old Testament. When this type of event happens to us all, we should all be on our knees praying for God to heal our heart and correct our sinfulness. In times of old, preachers would be saying, let us go to God and pray and ask him to heal our nation. We should ask him to renew our zeal, to restore our joy of our salvation. Give us good thoughts to replace bad ones and correct us as we need correction. That's what we need to be asking. In Kings, 1 Kings 8 through 30, 37 through 40, if there be a lame, if there be in the land famine, if there be pestilence, blasting, mildew, locusts, or if there be caterpillar, if there be enemy, disease, then in the land of their cities, whatsoever plague, whatsoever sickness there be, what prayer and supplication soever be made by any man, are by all the people of Israel, which shall know every man the plague of his own heart, the plague of his own heart, and spread forth his hands toward his house. Then hear thou in heaven thy dwelling place, and forgive and do and did to every man according to his ways whose heart knoweth. For thou even thou only knowest the hearts of all the children of men, that they may fear thee all the days of their life in the land which thou gavest to our fathers. That's a beautiful picture. Their ships. This is the reason they go down to the sea with no desire to look for God or to do good. Then a storm hits them. Some remember they are under God's rule and fall to their knees and start to pray forgiveness. And that's what we should do. Psalms 107 speaks of this. Matter of fact, Jesus actually did it. They that go down to the sea in ships that do business in great waters, these see the works of the Lord and his wonders in the deep. For he commands and raises the stormy wind, which lifts up the they mount up to the heaven, they go down again to the depths. The men are the bulkers, their soul is melted because of their trouble. These people reel to and fro and stagger like a drunken man and are at their wits' end. Then they cry unto the Lord in their trouble, and he brings them out of their distress. He makes the storm to calm so that the waves thereof are still. Then are they glad because they are quiet. So he brings them into their desired haven. Oh, that men would praise the Lord for his goodness for his wonderful works to the children of men. Let them exalt him also in the congregation of the people and praise him in the assembly of the elders. Notice how Jesus actually fulfilled this prophecy. Mark 4:36. And when they had sent away the multitude, they took him, Jesus, even as he was in the ship, and there were also with him other little ships, and there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship so that it was now full. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow, and they awake him, and say unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? And he arose, and he rebuked the wind, and he said unto the sea, Peace, be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And he said unto them, Why are ye so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? And they feared exceedingly, and said one to another, What manner of man is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him? All the men would praise the Lord. Lastly, Psalm 116:7-16. I use this quite a bit. Return unto thy rest, O my soul, for the Lord hath dealt bountifully with thee. For thou hast delivered my soul from death, my eyes from tears, and my feet from falling. I will walk before the Lord in the land of the living, I believe, therefore have I spoken. I was greatly afflicted. I said in my haste, All men are liars. What shall I render to the Lord for all of his benefits toward me? I will take my cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows. The Lord now in the presence of all of us, unto the Lord in the presence of all his people. And here it is. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. O Lord, truly I am thy servant. I am thy servant and the son of thy handmaid. Thou hast loosed my bonds. Not a sparrow falls to the ground that God isn't aware of it. And he knows the situation of every coronavirus patient. He knows those who are dying and those who will die in this pandemic. He loves them. None of them die without his awareness and without his full attention and without his absolute exhausted mercy. Every one of us is going to die sooner or later. And that's something that people are not ready for. You see, as a minister, I have to go to funerals all the time. I've gone over 100 funerals and done it over, I've watched people die so many times. And it's at that time that they're not wanting anything except to know that there's an eternity, except to start struggling with and realizing and attempting to realize what life is all about. Too often it's on their deathbed when they come to this. But all of us are going to face death sooner or later. In this postmodern world, we have our trash in containers that, and it's all gone. We have things that make anything that smell bad go away, anything that tastes, anything that we don't want to deal with or see. It's all done in places where we don't get to see all the trouble that's going on around us and all the things that we cause. And we make our life look and appear as if we're going to be here forever, but we won't be. The soul that sins, it will surely die. That's what God has said, and we have all sinned. And we've all fallen short of the glory that God has prepared for us. What does he mean that it's fallen short or missed the glory, amartia, missed the glory that God has had for us? What is that? He has this incredible idea whenever he fashions each one of us that he wants for us and that we can obtain. Not on our own, but by his graciousness, he can help us to become sons and daughters of the living God. And we're more interested in toys and building bigger barns. Therefore, it is appointed unto man once to die. Hebrews 9:3. It's your appointment. You have an appointment on God's book of books. And it's appointed once for us all to die. Hebrews 9:28. So Christ offered himself to die once to bear the responsibility for our sins, to act on our behalf when we could not do it for ourselves. He came and said, these people will not look for me. They will they will not see the wickedness that they are accomplishing by their foolishness and the detriment that they cause by doing that. So I will go down there and teach them. And we kill them for that. Time for some truth here. There is no truth in us. All of us are self-deceived. If we had truth in us, we would not need a Savior. The truth is, we need to turn. We need to repent. We don't see that. God must get the deception out of us. If we say we have no sin, if we say there is no God, the truth is not in us, and we deceive ourselves. How can that person who is deceived figure out what he needs to do? That's why Jesus came. He must defeat the lie. And he takes the lie. We live in a world so full of lies, it's getting to where you can't trust the newscaster no matter what. Everything in the newspaper, it's lies. It's full of untruths. It's full of what people want instead of what is the truth. He marched Israel around in the wilderness for 40 years in an attempt to remove the foolishness from their hearts. By man came death. 1 Corinthians 15:21. Listen to this. By man came death. And by man must come the resurrection. What does he mean? I know what the theologians say that there. But what did he mean there? What he meant was, when he created Adam and started the human race, Adam started to precedent. He sinned and he fell short of the glory of God. And he left the consequences of what he did to his generation after them, to his descendants. And each one of us have chosen to go that way. We have all turned aside. We have all gone astray. We've each one of us done it. Not Adam. We have each one of us. Whether there ever was an Adam. Some people believe there ever was an Adam. Okay. There certainly was above him. And he sinned and fell short of the glory of God. And I've never laid eyes on someone who hasn't done that. So let's put that aside and say that we all turn aside. All men fall short of the glory of God. All women do too. But the Bible says that by man must come to resurrection. We allow our enemy to steal our birthright. And if we have nothing in us more than that, then we deserve what we get. But we have a big brother. By man must come the resurrection. We need to stand up and fight for our birthright. We need to say, I won't take that anymore. And Isaiah, God says, nobody cares. Righteousness is falling in the street. We allow the enemy to... Who is this powerful demon who has taken over the human race? It is he who has the power of death. He has the power of death over every one of us. How does he have that power of death over every one of us? Right in Hebrew says he's the power of the air. And he speaks a lie into the air. And all of us readily receive it. And we believe him. And put our faith in him. Not in God. And until the stronger than he takes his lie and crumbles it in his face, exposes it for what it is. Until that happens, we are bond servants of him. And then Adam, the act of sin, the consequence of death to follow all who sin was placed on the books. All men have followed that law, and all men have died. And Christ chose the opposite of what Adam did. He chose not to sin. His life was not consistent with all have sinned. Now there is a man who has not sinned, and a new law has to be established for the man Christ. He was given his life back. John 10:17-18. Therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life, my human life, that I might take it again. No man can take it from me, but I lay it down of myself for you, for me. I have power to lay it down. And I have power to take it again. And here's what he said. How do I know this? Because this is the commandment I receive of my Father. And I believe my Father. And his last request, and last will and testimony, the man, Christ Jesus, John 17, he's still praying. To take as many as believed, repented, and allowed him to form his character in them, they could be resurrected also. Whew. I pray, I didn't know you had this much.
pray for them. I pray not for the world, but for them which thou hast given me. For they are thine, and all mine are mine, and thine are mine, and I am glorified in them. And now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world, and I come to thee. Holy Father, keep through thine own name those whom thou hast given me, that they may be one as we are one. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. Those that thou gavest me I have kept, and none of them is lost but the son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled. And now come I to thee. He's fixing to go home. And these things I speak in the world as a man, that they might have my joy fulfilled in themselves. I have given them thy word, and the world hates them because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. I pray not that thou should, that you would, I don't pray that you take them out of this world, but that you should keep them from the evil of the world. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. As thou hast sent me into the world, even so I have sent them into the world. And for their sakes, I sanctify myself. And part of this life and death was that sanctification, that they might also be sanctified through the truth and follow me. Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word, that they all may be one as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. And the glory which thou gavest me I have given them, that they may be one even as we are one. I in them, and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, that the world may know that thou hast sent me and loved me as thou hast loved, and loved them as thou loved me. Father, I will, and here's the part that I wanted in there. Father, I will that they whom thou hast given me, this is the man Christ Jesus, his last will and testament, I will that those whom you've given me be with me where I am, in heaven, that they may behold my glory which thou hast given me, for thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, the world has not known thee, but I have known thee, and these have known that thou hast sent me, and I have declared to them thy name, and I will declare it, that the love where thou hast loved me may be in thee. Thus, as in Adam's example, in consequence all die. In Christ's example, in consequence all made alive. That is what Paul meant in 1 Corinthians 15:22 when he said, for as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all be made alive. Potential for death was in Adam. The potential for life is in Christ. This is what God is trying to get us to see. We keep trying to avoid it and focus on this present life. Correction, getting our attention, backing off makes us think. When he backs off, it makes us think thoughts we would otherwise never contemplate. Listen, I've got to tell you this is the truth. Whether you like it or not, it makes his right and even good. It makes eternity for us who allow God to give it to us. In this time out, hopefully you have thought thoughts that you otherwise never contemplated. I believe you all hope. Eternity, reality seems like eternal reality seems more real and pressing today than it did then. All he is attempting to do for you and me is to adopt us into his own home, his own abode, the kingdom of God, and give us that kingdom with his Christ. As all atheists know and will tell you, God can't make you take eternal life with him. He can't make you go to heaven. Not because of your power, because of his. He is the one who protects your freedom, your sovereignty over your own decisions above his own will for you to be with him. And mister, that's a big protection, and that's a big will, and that's a big God that you're violating, and you couldn't do it unless God was protecting that of you. The alternative to God's chastisement is to turn his back on us totally. Finally, to all God's critics I say this morning, there is no innocent blood on God's hands. There is no genocide in God's history of innocent victims, only on ours. When I hear people talk about genocide, I say, you don't understand the Hebrew
Genocide is what we do to each other. There are no evil motives in God's heart. There's no deception with God. There is no injustice with God. You're lying if you think there is. Think if you want to. He'll protect you on that. There are no sinful thoughts in our God. He thinks no evil concerning us. He wishes no ill will. Peace on earth, good will toward all humanity. That's what Jesus came to serve us all in good will toward us. Father, we claim by finding fault in him. Neither can any human find fault in Christ or his Father. He said, when you've seen me, you've seen my daddy. He's not the bloody God of the Old Testament. The bloody God of the Old Testament doesn't exist. On Judgment Day, no one will find fault in him. I guarantee you that. If you're an atheist, look me up on that day. I'll have a smile on my face, you'll see it. Every knee will bow in honest consent with Pilate. Every accusation will be answered in total righteousness. And everybody, including donkeys, will agree. Every mouth will confess that God is true, that he is honest, that he is just, that he is loving, that he is merciful, and that he is more than gracious to all of us. He's even long-suffering. Nay, but O man, who art thou, who replies against God? Shall the thing form say to him that formed it, why hast thou made me this? I struggle with this text in Romans chapter 9 because of what theologians teach about Romans 7:8-9. And for a long time, until it dawned on me, God wasn't saying, I'll do whatever I please, and I'll call it righteous, and it'll be righteous because I'm the biggest dude in the world. What he was saying is, I am all of those things I tell you. I'm true, I'm just, I'm loving, I'm merciful. I give you the lips that you curse me with. I do all those things. I have no malice, no faith in it. Who are you to judge me, oh man? That's what he's really saying here. Not what we think he's saying. Let us repent and ask God to make us more conscious of his purpose with his present life. Instead of being overly concerned with building bigger barns. No, I'm done. Is trying to get our attention so that it doesn't get worse. And I've said this many times, and I said it just the other day. If you don't sense him backing on, people are going to stir crazy. Why? Because if God loses interest in us and he just walks away from us, and the atheists have the planet, and Satan can now pronounce himself as God. Oh, wait a minute, he doesn't exist for an atheist either. Pelosi can be God. One of the politicians. Somebody can be God now. Or nobody. Oh, how happy we'll be. We'll surely die. We'll die in fear. I sense fear all around me. And the reason I do is because we don't judge ourselves. That we don't face judgment. We don't look inside of our heart to see if there's anything wrong with us. And God wants us to. Don't wait till you get on your deathbed. That could be tomorrow. Tonight. Take this time out and do something. If we don't, it could get worse. It might anyway. You might be getting a book written by me that all the bloody moons are coming to pass. It's time to put on your white robe and go stand on the highest hill and Texas Hill Country and wait for them. You may be there. I don't think we are. But who am I to fly on the wall? I sure miss all of you. God bless you. Sorry this took so long. I'm glad that I'm finished with that piece now. God bless you. Trisha, thanks for coming. Oh, shake. Don't shake hands. Be friendly from a distance. Shake hands to be friendly. You're dismissed. God bless you.